myself again. But it's the only way you're ever gonna learn. You look back and it's all in the past. I'm dwelling on the thoughts I cannot say to you. If I don't say the words, then maybe it's not true. It feels alright.
Welcome along to NUFC Matters Dream Team with me, Steve Wraith, and delighted to welcome Steve Howey, who is here to pick his dream team today. He gets 11 players, he gets 5 subs, and he gets a manager. And following in the footsteps of Nash, Steve, interesting to hear what players have got to say as opposed to supporters. Have you found it difficult?
Absolutely. I've got an array of talent. By the way, I'm not delighted with that picture that you put on. You couldn't get a more modern one rather than when I was 12.
Blame John. Blame John the designer.
Jeez. Yeah, it is difficult because, I mean, I was there, I mean, as I said, I was there 14 years, but obviously made my debut in 89. So really from 89 to when I left in 2000, if you think of all the players that were there at that particular time, or in that time, very difficult. Because obviously there's players that I've got that I thought did superbly well before when Kevin first took over to get us to where we wanted to be. And then from there, the sort of the revolution of Kevin when we're in the Premier League. There's a vast array of players in there.
Okay. Well, as always, we'll start at the back and move forward. So we'll go with a goalkeeper. Who is Steve Howey's goalkeeper?
Well, can I go through what I've got, the list?
Of course you can, mate. Yeah.
Well, obviously, I played a lot with Pav. God bless him. I had Shaka as well. And obviously, Shea Given came in. For me, 3 fantastic goalkeepers. All of them on a given day, just like everybody else, could make a mistake. But that really wasn't the problem. I think the vast, for me, these 3 goalkeepers made saves where, when you're a centre half and you see a shot go past you, you automatically think that's in, because you know it's in the top bin or it's in the bottom corner and there's no chance the goalkeeper's going to get it. And you see any one of them 3, making that save. So it is a difficult one, but ultimately I think as a out and out shot stopper, probably is not the best kicker. And that's me being honest with Shea, or should I say a blockhead. But I'm going to go with Shea Given. As I said, I thought Pav and Chaka were absolutely superb. But ultimately, I'm going to go with Shea. Apparently, I think he's the number one choice, isn't he?
He is, yeah. I mean, we've done many of these with supporters and celebrity fans and players, etc. And it's interesting that Shea Given comes out on top every time. There's always, a tip of the hat to some of the other goalkeepers, but fantastic. Yeah, Shea was. And of course, record amount of appearances for a goalkeeper, yeah, as well at Newcastle. So deservedly so, in my opinion, in that number one position. Okay, depending on your formation, have you got one? What are you, 4-4-2, man? Are you?
I'm kind of 4-4-1-1.
4-4-1-1. Okay, so then we'll go right back first.
Again, when I first started under Kevin, it was really, well, I started initially under Jim Smith and then Ozzy. But Kevin brought in a player with good experience, unbelievably had the levels of he wanted everybody to be at in training. Excellent on the pitch. And that was Barry Venison. I thought Venis was a very, very good leader. He was loud in the dressing room. Not too sure about the barnet though, or the boots that he wore. But that was Venice for you. It was between Venice, Warren Barton, and Steve Watson. Because again, Watto, he broke into the team, I think, when he was 16, did ever so well. Very versatile, and I think probably that was, whilst it was his biggest feature, it was probably his biggest fault, because not his fault, but managers look at him and think, well, I can play him right back, I can play him left back, I can play him centre half, he can go midfield. I mean, he played up front, as well a couple of times. So, you know, very, very versatile player. But probably to go with Warren Barton purely and simply because he came with a big fee. I think a British record fee for a defender at that particular time. And it probably didn't start. I mean, it might have started okay for him. And then I think he did get a little bit of stick off the fans for a period of time. But to Warren's credit, he never, ever shook away from responsibility. He always wanted the ball. If he made a mistake, you could hear the fans sort of moaning. But he still wanted the game. But eventually, as I said, to his credit, he won them over because his performances bombing down that right-hand side and whipping balls in and the relationship that he had with the players. And in the end, the relationship that he had with the fans was excellent. So, again, difficult one, but pinned down, I'd say Warren.
Okay, Warren Barton is your right back. We'll go to the opposite side now. Who is your left back?
Again, it's a choice. I played a long time with Bez, but I grew up with Rob Elliott. I roomed with Rob. I mean, I'm still in touch with Rob. I see Bez still a lot on different social things, golf days or after dinners and stuff like that. Yeah, again, it is a tough one. Into the point where two brilliant lads, but Bez, you know, whilst I disliked him and we fell out a lot of times because he used to bugger off and leave me alone and just bomb forward, I'm going to go with him. I mean, he chipped in with the odd goal. He was very passionate about playing for Newcastle to the point where obviously, everybody can remember the fallout he had with David not tracking back. And that wasn't David's fault, according to Kevin Keegan. And Bez had lost his loaf and obviously showed a lot of frustration. And Bez got took off very quickly. But yeah, I'm going to go with Bez because, you know, he was quality.
Okay. That takes us nicely into the centre halves to make up your back four. Are you going to play yourself, Steve?
I'm not. No, I'm not one of these people that's into myself because I know I don't get picked. As I said, I had longevity at the club. It was curtailed a lot by three really bad injuries. But I know that with the managers that we did have, if I was fit, I played. So regardless who was there in my time, if I was fit, I played. But obviously, I've got Philippe Albert, who was just a wonderful talent. The boys that knew him, I mean, such a brilliant, brilliant lad off the field as well. Great character. So Philippe is in there. I had I also had Darren Peacock. You know, Peasy, I like Peasy because he defended. You know, he wasn't bothered about going forward. As I said, Philippe, he was like Bez. He just pissed off and didn't come back. But you accepted it because of the positiveness that they give the team by going forward. But Pisa used to just stay back and defend. I mean, we signed him on the strength of, obviously, we played QPR and Coley was up front and he did mark him out the game. And we bought him on the strength of that. I always remember, though, it was funny that they did a kind of get to know Darren Peacock. And I think it sort of said, what's your favourite drink? And he said, milk, which everybody realised very quickly that was not the case. great lad, though. Absolutely top quality lad. The other two that I've got is Nikos Davidas. Nikos... not the tallest, but I tell you what, brilliant in the air. Good defender, last ditch tackles. Again, though, like I sort of said, people do make mistakes, and Nick could make mistakes, but you know he was fully committed to what he had to do. So he was in the thinking. So was Alan Gomer. I liked Alan. I got on very, very well with him. Smashing lads. I mean, I could even put, I know you haven't got his picture, but I can even put somebody like Lauren Charvier in there. I'm certainly not going to put Marcelino in there. But ultimately, when it comes down to centre halves, the two that I'm going to go with. As I said, I think we'd spoke as well. I didn't play with them because obviously I'm going to put players in that I played with.
Yeah, and I think that's fair enough. Yeah,
and you know, listen, you don't play for Real Madrid if you're a bad player. You know, and Jonathan Woodgate would probably get in, but I didn't mm-hmm. play with him. I didn't know what he was like as a person. I'm assuming he was a very good person. But my two centre-halves would be Peasy and Phil.
Yeah, great combination. Lots of happy memories and entertainers. Back four. So that's where defence sorted out. And we're going to go into the midfield positions now. And this is where it starts to get difficult for a lot of people who've done Dream Team because, you know, we've had such a mass of great players, midfield and forwards. And I've seen a lot of people try to squeeze as many of these people in as possible, but there's always going to be somebody disappointed. So let's go right midfield.
Right midfield. I mean, we had a conversation before, and to be quite honest, I was racking my brains about who else played right midfield. It's kind of on the right wing. I'd thought about like Stephen Glass and people like that, and I thought Glassy did a really good job. But ultimately, you know, it's probably a no-brainer. It'll probably be Dizzy, Keith Gillespie. You know, on his day, could destroy players. I think prime example of that is the one against Barcelona when he tore to shreds, like the current, I think, Spanish fullback. He just tore him to pieces. And obviously, the ball's whipped in for Tino. Absolutely quality. Great lad. Still see Keith. Hasn't really changed that much, to be fair to him. Still looks quite well. So yeah, Keith Gillespie.
Yeah, Keith Gillespie, of course, a legend at Newcastle with his, as you see, his performance against Barcelona in particular, with helping Tino get his much publicised hat trick and a top bloke as well. And left side of midfield.
Again, I can mention two players, but that I didn't play with, and you're looking at maybe it's Lauren Robert and Ben Arthur. But for me, from day one, he absolutely blew me away. And that was David. He was just unbelievable. Fantastic touch. Could go right, could go left. Strong, athletic. Didn't really head it that much because he didn't have to. He was just that strong and he used to position his body in such a way where, I mean, he used to tell Bez, I don't care if the defender is up my arse. Like, not literally, but kind of tied to him. Can't just pass it in. You know, he said, not a problem. I think his first game was, against Middlesbrough. And he was actually playing against a very good friend of mine called Neil Cox. And I actually felt sorry for Coxie at the end because he just twisted him. But he did that to everybody, to be fair to him. I mean, obviously there was a couple of, there's always words and stuff said in dressing rooms because the ball wasn't getting whipped in, you know, when it should have been. But I just thought he was just a fantastic player and a fantastic specimen of a man, shall I say.
Yeah. I mean, what was he like in training? I can imagine the players probably, you know, must have been sick of him in training because he, you know, he just had such great control, etc.
Well, what we used to do is anytime we got a new player, I mean, obviously our training sessions were, we didn't focus on defending or like kind of anything set players wise. It was basically just, we did bits and pieces and then got into the five-a-side. But the five-a-side was of such intensity that players that weren't or didn't have the ability couldn't cope. I mean, there was plenty of players that got signed, got thrown into this kind of environment of the five-a-side. And the manager realised, I don't think they can handle it. And they went. And I can remember we had a player on the left-hand side called Scott Sellers, who was a brilliant player, Scoot. Really good, technically gifted with his left foot, was a bit of a wand, really. I mean, you could say that about Kevin Sheedy as well. Obviously, Sheedy was there. But what we used to do, especially with the forwards, me and one or two of the other lads used to just whip it into them, into feet. But also, we used to be a bit naughty because we used to like hit the top of the ball. So it would go up, but like spin down and bounce and shoot up. And it would just try and find them out. You could basically make just even a good player look like an idiot if you give them the types of balls that we were. And I think me and Bez fired a couple in and every single one stuck. And one in particular had stuck. I think he dipped his shoulder, came in on his left foot. I'm sorry, on his right foot and hit one. It went right in the stanchion. and Scott Sellers was next to us. And actually, Scott Sellers' words were, well, that's me fucked. So he knew he just wasn't getting in. I do apologise for the language, but that's the words that he actually used, because we just knew, wow, I mean, what a play. And, I mean, the fans loved him. I think Sue Parker loved him pretty much even more. But is it Sue Parker? Sorry.
Yeah, Sue Parker. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
But, yeah, great lad as well. Absolutely fabulous lad. And I think that was one of the big things as well. Not only were these players that I'm picking and naming were very, very good players. They were brilliant off the pitch.
Yeah, makes a big difference. Okay, centre midfield positions then. Two of those to fill.
Well, again, it's a big list. I've got Lee Clark in there, who I grew up with. Great lad. Obviously, there's Rob Lee as well. I thought, you know, when he first came out, I'm sure he started on the right-hand side, like kind of a right-winger type thing, when we got him for Charnel. And when Kevin convinced him, because he was supposed to be going to Middlesbrough, he convinced him Newcastle was closer to London than Middlesbrough, and yet he calls me thick. So there's Rob. I've got Bats, David Batty. That's a typical picture of Bats there. You know, he'd fight with himself if he couldn't fight with anybody else. He was a strange man, though. Great lad, but just strange, because he would turn up. He lived at Wetherby. And he would drive to the training ground at Durham. But he would have his training kit on. He would get out of the car, just run straight onto the pitch, warm up, lash a few balls about, didn't stretch off, would do his training, get back in the car and drive back to Wetherby. But when he did mix, the boys absolutely loved him. You know, kind of criticised a little bit because it was like side to side. But what a player. And I mean, an absolute somebody you definitely want in the trenches with you, because he loved the battle. And I mean, as I said, that picture kind of epitomises that. So there's him. Speedo, Gary Speed. Great lad again. And again, you know, Speedo was one of these players that had a period where he was a little bit under pressure and the fans were kind of on his back a little bit. I can remember one game in particular. I had just come back. I'd been out for a long while with a bad injury. I came back into the team. Rude named me captain. I think it was Duncan Ferguson's home debut. We played Wimbledon. And I think Spade's got the ball. And it was a kind of period, and the Newcastle fans might not like me for this, but it was a period when he got the ball that was kind of like, not boos, but like groans.
Yeah.
And very early doors, he got the ball and he tried to pass it, I think, to me, and it got cut out. And they went down and scored. So, of course, around the ground, you know, when you've got all those fans and the booing and stuff like that. But again, like Warren, you know, his quality and his character shone through and came through, because he more than won the fans over, scored some great goals, whether they were headers or right foot, left foot, and a great lad to have in the dressing room. So he's amongst the mix. I've got Nobby as well, Nobby Solano. Fabulous lad, great touch. Loved the trumpet. Seen him play it a couple of times, but still, you know, such an intelligent player. Free kicks wise, you know, you used to stick him in top bins, bottom bins all the time. He was unbelievable. And for a lad from Peru, how he adapted so well to the lifestyle up here and blending in with people. He took to that so well, but the fans took to him as well. So he's in the mix. And the last one I've got is Brace, Paul Bracewell. Obviously a big move because of his connections with Sunderland. Unbelievably scored on his debut. I can remember normally, first game of the season is normally red hot. And I think we played Southend. And
we did.
Pissing down. And I think we were winning 3-0. And I think Brace scored. And I can remember a lot of Sunderland fans were sort of saying, bloody hell, he's played like 100 or 200 games for Sunderland and maybe scored once. And on his debut for Newcastle, he scores. So he was a good player. I mean, obviously, he struggled massively with his ankle problem. That I think he sustained that from a challenge from Billy Whitehurst when he played for Everton.
That's right.
So he was constantly icing, But brilliant character in the dressing room. He was the kind of the sensible one, experienced one, you know, for like the idiots like me, Lee Clark, Steve Watson and Rob, because we were just full absolute wrongins. And he would sort of like sit us down and sort of say, listen, this is kind of not the way to go on or keep on doing this. So he was great to have in the dressing room for that as well. But ultimately, who am I going to go for? I'm going to go for Rob Lee. And purely and simply because he was there from the very start and came back, I'm going to go for Nash, Lee Clark.
Okay, so that's your two central midfielders sorted out, Lee Clark and Rob Lee. Okay, on to the forwards now, mate. Who was your first pick?
Well, again, I've got a list. So it's Al. I think without a doubt, he would probably be in absolutely every single person's kind of team. So he's in there. So he's in there already. So the other ones I've got to play, as a list, I've got Peter Beardsley. I mean, what can you say about him? I mean, he was just phenomenal player. I mean, the trick that he did, defenders knew it was coming, but they could still do absolutely nothing about it. You know, some of the balls he would play were absolutely frightening. And actually, sometimes some of the balls he would play, they might have been the best and they'd go out to play it, but Kevin would blame us because apparently we weren't on his same wavelength when it wasn't. It was just a shit ball. But he was just a fabulous player. So there's him. I've got also the one and only Celez. what a lad he was. I mean, you talk about that. I mean, obviously, his name itself, Celez, the boys absolutely loved him. I played against him a couple of times when he was at QPR. Found him very, very difficult, quick, strong, powerful, ridiculously good in the air. How he used to just hang. And, you know, he wasn't the tallest players. But as I said, to boot, what a fantastic person. So there's Les. Again, another player who was there, kind of there at the start. I've got Coley. Just a natural born finisher. I can remember when there was the talk about him possibly coming up, and Kevin was in deep conversation with Nash because they knew each other from the 21s. Obviously at Arsenal, I played against him. He was at Bristol City on loan. And I can remember showing him the byline. I think he had 6 inches to play with and he beat me. And I can remember thinking, wow, you know, there's not many could have had that close control to actually manipulate the ball in that kind of room, and turned out to have an unbelievable understanding with Pedro. So he's in the mix. And another one as well, as I sort of said, you know, from the start, that possibly mightn't get mentioned a lot, would be Ned, Dave Kelly. You know, what he'd done for the club at that particular time, when you look at that picture, you know, him and Gavin Peacock were absolutely phenomenal. You know, I was good for Ned, but I think the conversation, I could be wrong, might have to ask Ned about this, but I think the conversation was Kevin had sort of thanked him and sort of said, I'd try and get you the best deal that I possibly can, but we want to improve the squad. And Kevin ultimately just thought, you know, we want to build on this. Obviously, Kevin did, because we got Peter in, we got Les in, we got Alan. So I actually seen Ned a couple of weeks ago. Still looks really, really well. But I think the contribution that he made to that team at that particular time is invaluable. So, as I said, Al is already in there. But who, for me, is the stonewaller, because he's the best player I ever played with. And I played with England for a number of years and played with some top, top players. Peter Beardsley.
Brilliant stuff. Okay. Great team. Who are you going to pick then to fill the bench, mate?
To fill the bench.
You've got 5 picks.
Well, obviously, I've got to put a keeper on. Oh, dear me. It's so hard. Xhaka. Difficult one. No, do you know what? I'm going to change my mind. I'm going to go Pav.
Yeah. It tells you how close those two were, doesn't it? Because Kevin did continue to bring in goalkeepers in his time as manager, and he clearly found it difficult as well, Steve.
Yeah, because, I mean, I think at that particular time, you know, the goalkeeper, as a centre-half, you need a settled goalkeeper to have that understanding. And Kevin would change them regularly, you know, and that wouldn't be good for the goalkeeper either, because they'd be thinking, you know, if I make one little tiny rake, I'm out. Mm-hmm. And that didn't give either goalkeeper the confidence that they should have been given from the manager. So, yeah, it's a difficult one. But I'm going to plump for Pav.
Okay. Four left.
Midfield player, I'm going to go for... I'm going to go for a centre-half, and I'm going to go for Nikos, because I think he might nick you a goal from a set piece if we're kind of losing the game, because he was very, very good in the air. As midfield player, just if you need to shore up, if you're winning, I'm going to put Bats in there.
Okay, Bats, yep.
And I am going to go for subs on the bench. You can go long and he'll win it all the time in the air. That's Celez.
Okay, so Celez Ferdinand gets the nod as a sub. There he is.
And with him, as I said, I would love to put Ned in there, but obviously look what kind of call he did as well afterwards. So Coles goes in there.
Okay, that's your five subs as well. So you played under quite a few managers, Steve, because, you know, obviously you were there such a long period of time. Before you name your manager, you know, maybe talk about a few of the potentials.
Well, when I first actually signed for Newcastle, believe it or not, the manager was Jack Charlton. That's how long ago it was.
What was it like for a young kid? Because it's funny, last night I did a talk in with John Anderson, and, you know, he remembers Big Jack quite well. But what was he, you know, for a senior pro like Ando, you know, he was quite a foreboding character. Was he the same for you?
We used to train up at Benwell. And, you know, anybody that had been at Benwell, the training ground, I mean, the facilities were not good, put it that way. And... It was just when he come walking through that little tiny corridor, you know, I think what struck me was the fact he was tall, tall, lean, and he had that voice that was kind of like, and you're thinking, wow, you know, it was quite impressive, but quite kind of like, what's the word I'm looking for? It was just imposing. I think you knew he was there. So, and that's as a 13-year-old. So, of course, you're thinking, wow, you know, you kind of, you're here with the big boys here now. I mean, obviously, nowhere near the first team, but you're just kind of in there with all these players. After him was Willie McFall, excuse me, who I didn't really see a great deal of. And then, of course, ultimately, you know, Jim came in, Jim Smith.
We've just lost Jim recently, haven't we? But he was...
Yeah.
Hell of a character, wasn't he?
Oh, I was. I mean, I was obviously was apprentices then, and I used to have to be in first to make sure everybody was in and all that kind of thing. And you know, the gates used to be locked, so you'd get in the gates, you'd make sure you avoided the groundsman's dogs, because he had two Alsatians that were absolute animals that would just come running after you. So you'd have to see where the two dogs were. And then leg it to the door, because Dave Orchard was the great bloody hell. Where have I pulled that from? Dave Orchard was the groundsman. I forget what the bloody dogs were called, but they were menacing. And I used to go in, and as I was running up or walking up, his car used to be there, and I was thinking, well, the gates are locked. He used to like open the door. Because obviously I'm checking every room, making sure everything's all right, putting the big container of water on, so there's hot water for tea and coffee and for baths and stuff. And it opened up, and you'd open the manager's room, and you couldn't see him just for the cigar smoke. And he'd have his trousers off, but like folded nicely on the desk, and he'd be sitting there with a big cigar and a glass of whiskey. I was like, wow, I steam so, how's things on? like really husky, like voice, looking at the recent post. But I'm ever thankful for him because he gave me my debut when I was 17. Ultimately, it's at 17 in 1989 against Manchester United away as a centre forward. But after Jim, we had Ozzy Ardiles, and Ozzy was brilliant. I think he was massively into bringing on the younger lads, and I think probably that was the downfall in a way, because he got rid of experienced players like Mark McGee and Roy Aitken, and Quinny was kind of in and out at that particular time as well. But obviously there was likes of me, as I said, Watto, Nash, Lee Clark, Robbie Elliott, Lee Makin, Matty Appleby, all these kind of players we were playing, and basically were boys playing against men. And ultimately it kind of cost Ozzy his job, but a lovely, lovely fella, a great second man in Tony Galvin. I mean, I'm bringing up names here now, and people who might listen to this will be like, bloody hell, I can't remember him now. But sad to see Ozzy go, but ultimately who came in? KK. And I don't really have to explain too much about what happened with him and how good he was, because he just absolutely transformed the club. Obviously, when Kevin left, we had Kenny Dalglish. And I love Kenny. I don't know if some fans mightn't have been good with him, but I thought he was brilliant, an unbelievable manager. And of course, the man right next to him was there, who was, his presence, Terry Mack, with Kevin and with Kenny, was unrivaled, and it was invaluable, to be quite honest. Terry Mack's input was so, so good. Obviously, after Kenny, there was Rude Hullett. I got on very, very well with Rude. A lot of the players didn't. I mean, and we know who them players were. Surely Al and Rob Lee and Big Dunk. And there was the big game, obviously, against Sunderland, which could have gone either way. But I got on really well with them. But some, as I said, a lot of people didn't. And of course, after Rude, I think we had Sir Bobby. You can't say anything about him that hasn't already been said. Probably he's the best manager to kind of have it all. So he was a great man manager, and very, very tactically switched on. But I mean, because obviously look at the players that he had when he was at obviously Ipswich. There was, I think, Porto, Barcelona. I mean, being absolutely all over, did absolutely everything, PSD. So yeah, lucky enough to have all their managers. I could put Sir Bobby in, but I think just for the complete and utter turnaround of the club from where it was to where we were and where we got, I'm going to have to go with Kevin.
Brilliant stuff. Kevin Keegan is Steve Howey's manager. So the dream team that Steve picked today was Shea Given in goal, Warren Barton at right back, John Beresford at left back, centre-half partnership of Philip Albert and Darren Peacock. On the right midfield, we've got Keith Gillespie. On the left of midfield, David Junela. And alongside him in the centre, we've got Lee Clark and Rob Lee. Upfront partnership, well, Shearer and Beardsley playing off Shearer. And on the bench, quite a strong bench, it has to be said. But we've got Pavel Cernicek, we've got Nikos Dabizas, we've got David Batty, we've got Les Ferdinand, Sir Les. And you went for somebody else, and I haven't knocked that down. But we
Cole.
Did you? Cole, that's it. Andy Cole, of course. So Andy Cole is the fifth substitute and managing the team, Kevin Keegan. It's hard, isn't it, Steve? It's not
I mean, I hope some of the lads don't watch this, in all fairness, and that's not trying to be nasty to you. It's just the fact that any one of them ones that I've listed could be in. I think for me, the two that will be your mainstays is obviously Al and Peter. As I said, Peter Beardsley was the best player I ever played with. I think the two that will be in everybody's would be Alan Pedro, possibly Shea. I think, but the rest of them, you can pick any one and they wouldn't disappoint.
Steve, it's great to have you on. Thank you so much for doing it, mate. I'm sure the lads won't give you too much stick. I'm sure we'll get you back on again next time to talk about Newcastle United. But for now, thanks for doing your dream team. Take care, Steve.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Big thanks to our sponsors, Skips and Bins, telephone 0800 25 45 25 3, email inquiries at skipsandbins.com, website skipsandbins.com, easy contract free and pay as you go waste collection. Thanks to Darren Baldwin Funerals, based on Old Durham Road in Gateshead. Their phone number is 0191 478 2730. You can email Darren at darrenbaldwinfunerals.co.uk or go to the website darrenbaldwinfunerals.co.uk. Thanks to Garden of Healing Dispensary, CBD, hemp and cannabinoid specialists based on Nun Street. The GOHD.com is their website. And thanks again to Three Property Investments, who specialise in sourcing investment properties for their clients who are looking to invest in the Northeast. They offer a full in-house service from sourcing the deals to managing the properties for you. They've done over 100 plus deals in the past 12 months for clients all over the UK. Give them a follow on Instagram, matty.patter_northeastproperty and phil.reed_northeastproperty or email phil@threeproperty.co.uk if you're interested in getting a good property deal. Thanks to the lads at Mr. Vicky's Handmade in Cumbria. These are hot sauces and you can find them at mrvickys.co.uk or place an order by ringing 01768 210102. Thanks also to the lads at Blowhole Brewery. A fine amount of ales available from their website, www.blowholebrewery.co.uk. Thanks to Media Arts for all the help with the video technology. Thanks to qtechshop.co.uk, the makers of pool tables and snooker tables in Wallsend, Newcastle. And the guys who run our website, NUFCmatters.com. If you want to subscribe, hit the badge in the corner and you can subscribe for free. Still do 7 shows a week. Hit the thumb up to like the video and click share to share to your social media. We're also available as a podcast on iTunes, Spotify and the rest. And if you want to become a member, click join underneath this video or you can put your smartphone over the QR code. It will take you to the membership section of the website. If you choose to go that way, then you will get a pen, a cup, a scarf and a membership card and entry into the monthly draw for a one-off payment of £25. We also give you something for free. If you want a car window sticker, email john@nufcmatters.com and he will send you one if you are a subscriber. We also help the food bank on here. NUFC fans, foodbank.co.uk is the match day bucket. If you go there, you can make a virtual donation at any time of the year. And don't forget, Peter Beardsley Soccer School, October half term, Monday the 24th to Friday the 28th of October. You can book now, peterbeardsleysoccerschool.com. Peter's also running Monday night training on the 26th of October. Again, the same website. And if you want to meet Peter Beardsley, well, you've got 3 chances. Newcastle Legends game, Friday, October the 14th. The Peter Beardsley talk-in is taking place after the game. Tickets for this are available from nufcmatters.com. Adult admission is a £5, junior admission is £2. The talk-in is adults only, and that is a £10. And the events are all taking place at the Fox Hunters Pavilion in North Shields. We've got Peter Beardsley available, tickets available for the St. Dom's Catholic Club show. You need to go straight to their website you just buy your tickets there. And for this one at the Irish Centre, tickets are available now on NUFCmatters.com. Don't forget Supermax at the Dog and Parrot every pre-match and every post-match, every home game. And John Gibson and John Anderson are at Pumphrey's pre-match only. If you did like our true crime stuff, it has all migrated to the True Crime channel. So get yourself across there on YouTube and subscribe today.